monoliths versus distributed systems have been discussed, their trade-offs have been discussed more times than I can count. Most modern system architectures have monoliths as part of their early evolution, and so did ours. But what I do want to share with you today is the story of our journey from a monolith, well, a GraphQL monolith, to a distributed graph using Apollo Federation, and the lessons learned along the way, so it can help inspire your journey too. So how did it all begin? Well, data at Fidelity is organized into domain capabilities that help define key terms, entities, their purpose, and the relationship with other entities. This domain model aims to provide a stable reference with proper scope to enable cross-team and cross-initiative communication. Here's a quick visual of what the domains look like in the planning and advice capabilities, and we have many such capabilities and domains at Fidelity. And as such, we run on a rich microservices architecture across these business domains with APIs hosted in the cloud, interfacing clients over web, iOS, Android, and other channels with different teams owning different domains. It's fairly common for experienced teams to build presentation APIs, or BFFs, to aggregate and orchestrate data across these domains to serve their business needs. To move to a distributed graph, we needed domain teams to take ownership of these resolvers while still allowing the platform teams like ours to compose into a cohesive supergraph. And as a proof of concept, we decided to identify a slice of our monolith that we were most comfortable converting to a federated system. As you can see here, most of the resolvers were a one-to-one mapping between resolvers and the domains. But the passport resolver, depicted here in red, was a little bit more interesting. We sort of had created a monolith within a monolith. This resolver integrated across three domains: customer profile, customer entitlements, and customer notifications. So we thought carving out this piece, which is a monolith, monolith resolver in itself, and using it to convert to federation would help us understand how we could do this at a much grander scale. I don't know if it's legible, but we could have a passport gateway that would then federate out to these other subgraphs and become a federated system on its own, which could then be called by the existing GraphQL monolith until we were ready to convert the whole system. We started here because we thought that the impact was greater. The complexity of this resolver talking to multiple domains could help us prove that federation works, and again, like I said, would help us understand how to do this at a much bigger scale. We wanted this new architecture to be more intentional, less coupled, and keep up with the rapidly growing pace of development happening on our platform. Historically, we had fallen into the bad habit of overfetching data by having static queries in the client. So one intention was to enable dynamic queries by having the client specify only the fields that they needed at any instance of the conversation flow. The other was reusability. The status quo usage of this API resulted in a lot of coupling and special business logic, which resulted in some really weird code paths. Going forward, we didn't want to repeat any such situations. In the federated state of things, we wanted to make these subgraphs reusable, so much so that they could eventually be owned by domain teams. Our goal is to continue to empower and enable conversation flow developers to build more things faster, better, with less friction, while distributing responsibility of data where it truly belongs in a federated system. We think that this architecture would help us address bottlenecks with CI/CD job failures, delegate error handling down to subgraphs owned by domain teams, and also handle deployment and monitoring issues. With domain teams creating their own subgraphs, we would be able to allow conversation flow designers to continue to reuse subgraphs. We would also be able to allow our clients that love the simplicity of communicating with a single API to continue to communicate with the gateway in this case and care nothing about the graph architecture underneath. We will also be able to enable variable caching for data that has different TTL needs via individual subgraphs. So, in as much as federation is meant to unify our downstream APIs, I think it also unifies how we observe our downstream APIs. Our platform conversation platform is observation and analytics heavy. So as we added more teams and more use cases to it, the dashboard quickly snowballed and became homogenous. So with moving to federation, we can distribute individual subgraph observability down to the domain teams while continuing to have our dashboard and monitoring centralized by having tracking IDs passed down from the gateway all the way down to subgraphs and resolvers. Developing the federated system at Fidelity has been and continues to be a learning experience. As you start to scale to maybe greater than 5-7 teams working on the single API, you really need to start thinking about DevEx. Once you get to a level of graph complexity, that's where federation can truly help handle complex graphs, optimize collaborations, avoid merge conflicts, thereby improving developer velocity. Thank you so much for coming out today.